You're now watching the Mike Missanelli Podcast on the Bet Rivers Network.
Good day, everybody, and welcome to the Mike Missanelli Podcast brought to us by Bet Rivers. Tuesday, July 23rd, our episode is playing today, and it's baseball-oriented at the top because we have a very special guest, the brilliant play-by-play man for the Phillies radio team, Scott Franzke, who sounds brilliant no matter what schlub from the street they throw in the booth on him. Scott, how are you doing today?
I'm doing great, Mike. How are you?
I'm doing good. Now, you're in Minnesota. Phillies lose again last night. And I don't want to say there's a sense of panic here, but you know how Philly fans are. They overreact a lot. This is still, in my opinion, the best team in the league. I think the numbers prove it. But they're in a little lull, as we say. Don't say slump. We say lull, losing five of their last seven. From your perspective, what's going on right now?
A little bit of everything. I mean, part of it is, that's ebbs and flows of a baseball season. You're going to go through times like this. And what's remarkable is that they just haven't had any stretches really like this to this point. I mean, and one of the reasons why they have great starting pitching, so that eliminates long losing streaks, kind of takes you out of that. And, you know, the starting pitching hasn't been as good as it was before. But I think anytime you go through a stretch like this, it's something a little bit different each night. So it might be, you know, last night they ran into a really good pitcher. Bailey Ober was good and shut him down. The bullpen didn't keep it close late, and so they didn't have a chance late. I think it's a little bit of that. You know, a couple nights ago in Pittsburgh, the bullpen gives up a lead. I think anytime you struggle and you go through a stretch like this, it's usually a combination of a lot of things.
All right, let's focus on what may be real problems. So last night, Ranger Suarez does not get the job done again. The obvious implication is, has he hit some kind of a wall? What's going on with Ranger? What are people saying down there about it?
I mean, I don't know that he's hit a wall. I mean, his command has been off. I think he's really struggling with some of his secondary pitches. Last night, he hardly used his changeup at all. I don't think he had a real good feel for it and kind of bagged it. But that's such a huge pitch for him. Fastball command, I thought, was a little better than maybe his last time out, but still not where we would expect Ranger to be. I think it's something that, you know, every pitcher goes through it and you try to keep the lows to a short stint. And I know it's getting to be a long run here for Ranger without a win. I think the one thing, though, he came out of it healthy and that seems to be, that's important, obviously. But I don't have any long-term concerns with regard to Ranger, but I think he really needs, especially his changeup, he's really got to figure that out.
And I'm not too worried either. I mean, listen, he's getting up there in innings and maybe not used to pitching these kind of innings, but I think by playoff time, if you've got four guys that you're going to throw at somebody, they're in a lot better shape than everybody else. So now let's look at the bullpen. We've seen this with Alvarado before, and then he flashes back. Do you believe they need one more right-hander for high-leverage situations?
I mean, I don't think you can ever say you don't need another pitcher. I think they need I know they'd love to have more. I mean, you look at the way you use a bullpen during the regular season. It's very different when you get to the playoffs and you're starting to dip into that bullpen earlier in games. You're matching up earlier in games, fourth, fifth inning at times. So I definitely think that they would like to get another arm, be it a righty or a lefty. I think a righty would be preferred. But I think they're going to work to try to add arms. The odds of going from now to the end of the season without having a guy that ends up on the IL, pretty slim. I mean, that's just the nature of the game. So you need as much depth as you possibly can have.
I know you guys probably have these conversations off air and stuff, but, you know, Mason Miller would be a prime get, but it's going to cost you so much to get him. Is it worth the cost if that's a guy that you can get?
I don't think the A's are going to deal him. I really don't. But that's just me. I don't think the Phillies are going to pay the price that would take. And I'm kind of on board with that. I mean, I don't think Mason Miller's got really good stuff, but Mason Miller also doesn't have like a 5-year track record of doing this. This is a guy who's really doing this year for the very first time. And at some point he will struggle, and he will have to go through it and he will have to make adjustments. So, I don't know that I'd be willing. This is me talking. I'm not sure I'd be willing to do it. I don't think the A's are going to do it. And I don't think the Phillies would want to pay that price.
I guess the example's Helsley, where you can go bad, but I just think there is a guys like Marte, I don't think are capable of handling that kind of situation. Kirkering maybe. I just think they need a right-hander. It's a little more reliable because you never know about Dominguez. So I might be tempted to do it, but we'll see what Dombrowski does. Now let's look at the outfield situation where they're not getting the input. You know, Castellanos has had some moments lately, but you know that whole scramble from center field to left field is a little perplexing for a team that's supposed to contend for a World Series when they're not getting necessary output from the outfield. How do you see that?
Yeah, I think that's definitely an area they'd like to upgrade. And will it be a guy like Randy Arozarena or Luis Robert? That a guy who could play every day. I don't know that it'll be that. But they need somebody who's going to do damage against left-handed pitching. They absolutely need somebody who can hit left-handed pitching because they're going to see it. When they get to the postseason, they're going to see left-handers. Just think about if you got to a postseason series with Atlanta, let's say they're healthy, they're going to throw it Freed and Sale at you. And, whether they can line up their pitching the way they want, after a first round or whatever, you're going to see them and you're going to have to find a way to beat them. And it's probably going to take somebody who can mash lefties. So I think there's no doubt they're on the lookout for it. I think they need it. I think they want it. And I think they have assets to try to make it happen.
Talking to Scott Franzke, play-by-play voice, Phillies radio broadcast team. Scott, I always like to look at people's career because, it's not an easy climb to get where you are. And so let's go back to the beginning. You're a Texas guy. Were you ever a Dallas Cowboy fan?
No, yeah, as a kid I was. It just got to be kind of a comical show there. Post Jimmy Johnson and Jerry Jones and that whole business. And at a certain point, I kind of just became a baseball guy. There was once upon a time I would have worked any sport. If you had offered me a football job, I would have run with it and done my best with it, or basketball or whatever. But once I kind of became a baseball guy, I really tuned out on football in a lot of respects. Just the baseball season is so long. And when the season ends, I just, kind of forgot. I moved away and did minor league baseball. And so kind of lost touch. My father, who passed away recently, he was a Cowboys fan to the end. And I don't know how many times I heard that man say, "Oh, the Cowboys are never going to win as long as Jerry Jones is the owner." I heard him say that so many times. At least he got to see his Rangers win the World Series.
Yes, he did. So you knew there was no way you could even reveal what you just revealed to me when you came up here, right? There's no way you could have been labeled as a one-time Cowboy.
Yeah, well, I mentioned that I was from Texas a lot, rather than Dallas specifically. Yeah. No, I get it. When I was working in Dallas, after I'd gone away and done minor league baseball, I was working in Dallas for their CBS radio affiliate, and I did pre and post game shows for the Rangers. I filled in on their broadcast, but I also had to work year round for the radio station, and I took one or maybe two trips to cover Cowboys games. One was to Seattle and the other was to Philly. And, the routine, for the football is you fly in on Saturday and you're there Saturday night and you kind of wander around. And then the next day you go to the stadium and we're on there was a media bus basically. And they're taking us right down Patterson Avenue. And I mean, the fans are lined up along the street there, over by the Wells Fargo Center, you know, up along that gate along the street. And I mean, middle fingers are flying and, you know, everything. And it's just media people on the bus, not even any of the team, but they're giving it to us. So that was actually my first time going to a sporting event in Philadelphia. Was a Phillies, Eagles Cowboys game. I'm trying to think what year that would have been. I think 2005 would have been the first time.
I don't know if you've ever heard this story on how nuts people are up here, but a pregame tent radio pregame tent show had a guy. He called himself Chainsaw, and he literally brought a chainsaw into the big rally booth that they had out mm-hmm. there, and he had a blow up doll of Troy Aikman. And he started the chainsaw with the intent of sawing Troy Aikman's blown up doll in half. Well, a chainsaw and plastic don't mix. and it grabbed and it clawed the chainsaw and it slashed his arm. And he banded. Now, this is a wound that needed a hell of a lot of stitches. Right. He bandaged it up and went to the game anyway. That's the kind of nut fan that are anti Dallas Cowboys in this town.
Yeah, I didn't see the chainsaws come out, but we saw a lot of other stuff coming out, that's for sure.
All right, so you started your career in Texas at Prime Sports Radio, and I assume you knew you would need some kind of play-by-play experience because that's what you wanted to do. And here come the Kane County Cougars. Yeah. So tell me about that experience in where's that, Illinois?
It's suburban Chicago, essentially. It's far west suburbs of Chicago in Geneva, Illinois. If you're familiar with that area, Geneva, Aurora, Naperville, out that way. In working some with the Rangers people, they suggested to me, the guys in the booth there, they said, hey, look, if you really want to do this, you're going to need to go to the minors. Because I was just doing a handful of, you know, high school games a year or whatnot. So you need to go learn to do it every day and learn what the rhythm is like and learn how to, you know, work 6-7 days a week without a day off and see if you really like it. And so I went to Kane County. I mean, I got really fortunate because it was, as I said, suburban Chicago, and they had good crowds, and it was low A ball, but they had really good crowds. And so made my tape sound a little better because it sounded like something really was going on. And, you know, I mean, there were other teams in the league that weren't the same, you know, in terms of attendance and the success or whatever. And we had some good players that came through, which was fun. We were a Marlins affiliate at the time. So actually that was my first time ever meeting Dave Dombrowski. He was the GM of the Marlins. And the Marlins actually came through Kane County and did an exhibition game with the low A team. But yeah, we had some really good players. Adrian Gonzalez.
Was Miggy down there when you were there? Miguel Cabrera? Yeah,
I saw Miguel's.
Wow.
Yeah, we had our infield. My last year in Kane County, our infield at first base was Adrian Gonzalez. At third base was a guy named Josh Willingham, who played for a lot of years in the league, ended up in the big leagues. Cabrera was at short, and there was another guy by the name of Josh Wilson, who I think ended up with about a 16-year career. He was kind of a 4A guy, but played a lot. So you had four future big leaguers on the infield, which for a low A team, that's pretty remarkable.
Pretty good. So, all right, from there you go back to Texas a little bit, and then you get the Phillies call. What was that like? Because this is the big spot.
Yeah, really exciting for me. I mean, I didn't realize what a great place I was landing in. I mean, I just wanted to do play-by-play every day, something I wasn't doing in Texas. I was mostly doing the talk show, and I would fill in here and there. So I would have gone just anywhere, really. I had interviewed earlier in the winter with Houston and didn't get that job. And then I was actually, believe it or not, I had a plane ticket to go to Pawtucket to interview for their job. And again, this is to go back to AAA just because I wanted to do play-by-play. And Pawtucket, you know, a spot where you do radio and you do TV. And I told the folks in Pawtucket, I said, hey, look, I have this interview with the Phillies. I don't know how that's going to go, but and I told the Phillies the same thing. I said, I'm ready to go if you guys want me. And when they called and said, yes, I actually, the next day I was supposed to go to Pawtucket. And I called them up and I said, I won't be on that plane tomorrow. Sorry.
Wow. Yeah. That's good. So who was the guy that actually reached out to you? Who was the guy that actually made the hire?
Well, it was in my interview, there were three people. Rob Brooks was in there. And Scott Palmer was in there. And David Montgomery. And it was those three guys. And I don't know what the logistics were, or the waiting, or who had the final say. I assume David was really the one who had the final say. But to end up here, you know, the team was getting really good. To end up in a place where where it matters, that you can't say that about every market, that it matters. And I think that's for what we do, to know that it matters to the fans, day in and day out, it matters to them. And then, the partner thing, that worked out okay, I guess.
The three fine gentlemen in that interview, by the way. Your radio job is a lot more stringent than those lightweight TV guys, because you have to do every game. Spring training, I have to laugh because the Phillies are on the radio and those guys are still kind of relaxing before they get on the air, and you're put to the fire right away. Is radio more was it more your passion than television? For what reasons?
Well, I think at a certain point in your career, when you're starting out, you're going to do whatever they ask you to do. And I had always done radio. I had only done a little bit of television work. And I liked doing radio. I liked the nuances involved in radio as opposed to television. Now, that's not to say, I've said this before, because I did get offered a TV job once and I turned it down to stay with the Phillies. And one of the reasons why is I wanted to do the playoffs. And having gotten there early in my time with the Phillies in 07, 08, and being a part of it then, that's what I wanted to do, was I wanted to make sure I wanted to be on the games during the postseason, because you talk about what matters, and obviously those things really matter to fans, and for us to do the games, it's just so much fun. It's intense. It's definitely a different kind of intensity to the regular season. But that's what I wanted to do. And so in order to do the playoffs, you got to do radio. And
with that, you forged some legendary calls that people recreate all the time for you in your career, with obviously Bedlam of the Bank being, it might be your epitaph. Have you thought about that? Do you get, you put that on? I mean, you're many years from thinking about that, but might that be, on the stone?
Yeah, I don't know. I like that. I'm humbled that people, it's resonated with people, that they liked it or whatever. And, I like I say, Bryce did most of the hard work. So he was the real.
Last thing, you've had a couple of partners. Of course, Larry Anderson is the partner that, people are most familiar with you and the chemistry you guys have developed, and now Stocker comes in there. First of all, tell me about first working with LA and what you needed to be to bring the best out of him.
I think, again, going back to the interview process, I've said this before, but that was one of the things they told me. They said, we have this guy, we think he's usually about the funniest guy in the room. But we don't get that out of him enough on the air. And so that would be what we'd be looking for. And, so that was kind of that was what I had focused on from the very beginning was, and it just so happens that, I mean, we share kind of a similar sense of humor in this business, you can't pick where you work necessarily, and you can't pick who you work with. And you know, I got really lucky on both aspects. I talked about why Philadelphia in particular, but as for the partner, I just can't imagine I could have ended up with anybody better.
One of the great parts of the broadcast is we know Larry Anderson just loathes umpires, and I like when you slyly let a little match under him to get that going.
Yeah, well, you know, I mean, like I said, that's getting his personality out. So, and you know what? He's so much fun to work with because it matters to him. He cares about it. He cares whether they win or they lose. He's honest about it. And he also likes to have fun with it. So he's willing to play around. He's okay with making fun of himself. And I think that's important for anybody in this business, you know, to be able to maybe not take themselves too seriously sometimes. And so, yeah, I think it's been great. It's just been so much fun to be a part of it with him.
How do you do with family, the road trips and family? How do you negotiate all that? Do you take the family on the road occasionally or
yeah,
no?
Yeah, they will come. You kind of have to. They came to London, which was awesome. And I have three kids and, you know, 14, 10, and 10 twins. And, you know, there's a lot going on at home. They're busy. They got a lot of stuff they want to do. And, you know, their activities that they're involved in, and you try to squeeze in an hour or two here or there to go out and see them play or you know, or whatever, some function at school if you can make it. And, you know, I've become a little bit better at trying to manage the travel part of it and, you know, maybe fly on my own and get their day of the game and have an extra off day at home, something like that. So, but they'll come and, you know, they've been to the playoffs a lot. My son he's 14, you know, and they went to the playoffs in 22. It's like a real coming of age for, you know, a kid, a young fan who's watched this team not make the playoffs year after year. And so it was really cool to see it. It was great for us to get back to it after so long away, but it was great for me to watch them and see it through their eyes in a new way. And it was really, really cool, meaningful for me in that regard.
Scott Franzke, a pleasure, man. I love talking to you, and keep it going, and we'll see where this thing goes. I can't imagine that this is not going to end in a World Series appearance this year from what I can see.
No, we certainly hope so. Yeah, they're a good team. No team is without flaws. And there's some luck involved when you get to the postseason, but we'll see how it goes. I'm looking forward to the ride.
Sounds good. Scott, thanks a lot, buddy. We'll talk to you later.
Appreciate it, Mike.
That'll do it for the Mike Missanelli podcast for today. You can check me on Twitter at MikeMiss25 and also email mike@mikemiss.com. A reminder that I am involved and I will launch it today, another podcast that you're going to find on a YouTube channel. It's called The Coldest Murder. We are recording our first episode today. It is about the murder and rape of a young 9-year-old girl in a Catholic church around the corner from where I grew up in Bristol Borough. It's been a cold case for 62 years. We are trying to bring some light and some more information into the case on why it was never solved and who could have been the murderer. So that's happening. And we'll follow my Twitter for some more information on that. For Darren, I'm Mike Missanelli. Have a great rest of the day, everybody. And we'll talk to you Thursday. Bye-bye.